So one of the things that I often find when people ask questions or bring up problems that they have with their horses or challenges is they tend to be asking or focused on like the end part of the unwanted behavior. And rarely are people taught how to recognize the initial signs of maybe resistance in the horse, defensiveness in the horse, concern in the horse that is going to contribute to behaviors that maybe are counter offers to what we're requesting of him. Meaning that many times if we're asking the horse to do something, it will sometimes feel like the horse has other ideas and other physical responses than what we've asked. And then people go, well, now what do I do? Rather than recognizing the initial beginning signs of when a horse is perhaps defensive to how we're communicating with them, noticing how often the horse is mentally fixated elsewhere or distracted by the herd or his thoughts back with the barn despite his body being out on the trail ride or whatever the scenario might be. And so my goal in a lot of the videos that I post and that I try to share is helping break down for people to start to recognize and put value to equine behavior. And I find that sometimes when there's a general discussion about equine behavior, it's presented with a human emotional filter. And so what I mean by that is based on what the horse is doing, how it makes a person feel is how they describe the behavior. And so this creates a filter. It creates a human story, like explaining the horse behavior without having any accuracy as to what the horse is doing, why he's doing it, or being able to break things down in a way to start communicating to help the horse maybe work through his resistance, his defensiveness, his fear, his worry, his concern, whatever it is that he might be experiencing. So something that I often suggest to folks is notice how often do you first just stop and observe your horse, whether it's maybe before you catch him, if he's out in the pasture or in a stall, or if you're watching your horse, you know, on his own, when you're not right there handling him, and start to notice how often your thoughts have something to do with like your emotions and how you feel about what the horse is doing. You'll see a lot of videos here on TikTok and other social media platforms that are chiding the horse, are judging the horse, are critiquing the horse, are making up these supposed to be humorous comments about why the horse is being so dumb or so stupid or so resistant, or we need to teach him a lesson, or whatever the rhetoric might be. That is all coming from human emotion and human ego, and it has nothing to do with actually addressing why the horse is behaving as he is. And for a lot of folks, they are taught to be, I'm going to say, hopeful in trying to impose a strong enough communication and aids with the horse to where he will physically comply and that he will physically tolerate what's asked of him. But rarely do people acknowledge what the horse is experiencing and how that's going to influence his future responses to our interaction. Meaning, if each time we catch the horse, we have to do so either with bribery of some sort of food or grain or whatnot, or we have to catch the buddy horse in order to catch him, or we have to chase him around the pasture before he finally gives up and we can walk over and halter him. That means that everything that he's experienced during the catching, we have been teaching him to be defensive towards us. We have been teaching him to perhaps be concerned by our presence. We have been teaching him to be anticipative as to what we might do next. And if he's carrying those mental and emotional, we'll say that chaos, how will he respond to anything else that we ask of him? Meaning when we go to lead him, when we ask him to stand tied, when we go to tack up, when we go to get on, all of that chaos continues to influence how he responds to us, which means that we're going to wind up seeing him offer more anticipative, more resistant, more avoidant behavior sooner and sooner in the interaction. And sometimes what happens is people say, well, then you just need to teach that horse a lesson. You need to get stronger. You need to get more aggressive in your communication. Make him run, make him work if he's not willing to comply, you know, all of these, this different rhetoric that people come up with. And again, you have to say, well, if the horse is already starting in a fearful state, if he's already starting with defensiveness towards human communication, and now we're going to impose more pressure in making the horse run or flee, if you will, during that moment, what are we actually teaching him for the future? And this is where so often the tools or the skill set that people are taught really wind up causing a lot more harm and damage to the interaction with the horse than actually building trust or quality. So there's a few recent videos that I've posted. I'm always posting a variety of videos of different horses that come in from all over the country. And again, I'm often the last stop after all of the mainstream ways of working with horses quits working. You know, the horse who gets aggressive and violent and attacks people, the horse who climbs out of the fencing and, you know, tries to avoid people at all costs, the horse who can't socialize and is aggressive towards other horses, the horse who is always pulling back and flipping over, the horse who bolts and takes off, the horse who's uncatchable and untouchable, you name it, it usually gets sent here if it has an owner that's dedicated enough. And most of the owners who wind up with horses like this usually aren't the ones who caused all the trauma creating the horses to be like this. It's often been masked or contained through strong enough riders to kind of hide what's really been going on. And then an unsuspecting person winds up with a horse who has all this fear, trauma, defensiveness, dangerous coping mechanisms, we'll say. And then you wind up in a scenario where they feel overwhelmed and they don't know what to do. So a lot of what I like to share and talk about and discuss is trying to help people recognize way before trauma is ever created. And sometimes what I find that I struggle with is it's really hard to get people to understand how little it takes to create trauma in a horse, because so many horses that we see in many common everyday scenarios are constantly living in a high state of stress or concern or anticipation, are constantly carrying tension. And so what happens is if all the horses around you kind of look the same, then you don't notice if your horse is carrying anything different, because it looks like that's just how horses are. And people will actually explain, that's just how horses are. Have you ever had it where maybe something has changed in your horse's environment and your horse, you know, suddenly stops and dramatically looks at it, and someone will say, oh, stupid horse, you know, that tarp or that horse blanket was hanging on the fence earlier. It's just in a different place now. Come on, you're fine. Keep going. Those type of mentalities is reflecting what the human is trying to gain out of the horse experience, which is the human has a goal and the horse must comply, irrelevant of what the horse is experiencing. Without acknowledging all of the different things that we're doing that is triggering either fear or concern or defensiveness in the horse, then each aspect of our communication is magnifying his distrust. And so if during each of our interactions, we just keep increasing his distrust, eventually at some point, it's going to become mentally overwhelming and he will, as people say, all of a sudden physically explode. But what happens is people don't recognize that, like, before that explosion, there is a bunch of different signs in all of his body language. That's why so many of the videos I post about, I think I posted one this morning, and breaking down all these different horse behaviors that we can practice observing and learning to notice. Like, how often does my horse blink? Where is his eyes? Are they focused on the direction that I'm actually asking him to move? Or is my horse always carrying his ears with this rigid, tense, backward direction where he's always thinking backwards instead of about what's in front of him? Is he always physically unbalanced? Does he trip? Does he stumble? What does it look like? Does he actually lay down and sleep? Or is he in such a high, mentally anticipative state that he can't literally let down to lay down, because they're most vulnerable when they lie down? And so now he's experiencing sleep deprivation, which then adds to his anticipation, his fear, his defensiveness. We don't notice all of these subtle things because much of the time we have an agenda and we don't really have room to acknowledge the horse. So let's take the horse where we're thinking of a scenario where we go, all of a sudden my horse exploded. And let's backtrack a little bit and let's notice how easy or what was the quality of catching that horse? What was the quality of haltering that horse? Meaning, if you go to put the halter on, does your horse dive his nose to the ground? Does he turn his head away? Does he put his head up in the air to avoid the halter? Does he accept you putting the halter on? And as soon as you go to lead him, he's walking off, or he's kind of pulling on you or dragging on the lead rope, or he's walking into your personal space. If you ask him to stop while you open and close the gate, is he able to stand quietly, or is he stand still, but he's looking around and hollering to his buddies? Does he autopilot go out the gate and kind of accidentally sort of seem to run into you or be fussy about being asked to stand a second or two longer when you go to lead him towards wherever it is that maybe you groom or tack up? Does it seem like he gets slower and heavier with pressure resisting on the lead rope? Does it seem like he sees grass and he goes dragging off to the side, irrelevant of you being on the other end of the rope? All of these different things that is so, I'm going to say, inconvenient for people to slow down and acknowledge because they have an agenda. it's very, very hard for them to acknowledge that the horse has already mentally left, because in their mind, they physically have the lead rope in their hand and they have the horse what seems like sort of next to them or sort of in close proximity. And so they say, hey, we must be good, so let's just keep going. Rarely do people acknowledge, is there quality? Have I checked in with the horse? Is the horse mentally available? Meaning, can I direct his thought and then his movement? For a lot of folks, they're taught to move the horse's feet in order to get the mind. For me and my personal approach in working with horses, I'm only 5'2". I can't manhandle a horse to force them compliance. I work with all kinds of horses, from huge draft horses, horses off the track, warm bloods, miniature horses, mules, donkeys, everything in between. So there's a whole different variety of personalities and how we work with these different horses and their confidence levels and so on. I'm not going to physically make any of those horses comply. Now, sometimes people can use certain tack and equipment and leverage and fear mechanisms and seem to get a horse to comply, but it's often only temporary, because at some point, whatever pressure it took to force compliance is going to take more pressure, and you usually get less compliance, and it becomes less and less and less until you actually teach the horse to then offer aggressive behavior towards the human to make the human go away. So most of the aggressive horses that I meet, it really is something that humans have taught them to do. It is not something that they are born with. Once in a huge, huge, huge great while will you meet a horse that will say, physically has things going on that then triggers aggressive behavior. But for the most part, most of the behavioral things that I see where people talk to me about aggressive horses, it's out of protecting themselves. It comes from a place of fear, and it comes from a place of being defensive towards the human pressure and human communication that they've experienced. So in terms of ignoring all of these subtle things, or thinking of it's not really convenient because, you know, I want to go for a ride, I only have an hour, or the sun's setting, or I only have so much time, or I have other things I need to do, my horse is sort of leading, let's keep going. My horse is sort of willing to stand still, let's keep going. What people miss is that they are constantly teaching the horse that when he is subtle and reasonable in his communication, he is often ignored, or more often, he is actually critiqued, meaning the humans add more pressure to force compliance. And so you can see how this vicious cycle continues. So a lot of times when I hear things, because people will ask me, like, in these questions, you know, my horse won't let me put the saddle on. He stands fine when I'm brushing him. I go to walk towards him with the saddle and he moves away, or he backs up even if he's tied. Or my horse, I walk him up to the mounting block. I go to get on. He stands perfectly fine. I put my foot in the stirrup and all of a sudden he's backing up, or he's walking forward. My horse seems fine if I ride him in this part of the property, but I can't ride him in another part of the property. These are all common things that I get for that. It doesn't matter on the age or experience of the horse or so on. They're common questions that I get, and there's many, many others. But again, all of these things are symptoms. They are all an accumulation of the horse's initial communication being ignored.